So I'll get started. Yeah. Hi, guys. Welcome, everybody. After lunch, last day of the conference. Glad to see so many people here. Hopefully, I can keep you awake after after lunch. Should be possible, because guys, you have to also help me out. I do a live coding session here, so if something goes wrong, please help me to figure out what goes wrong. Something about myself first. My name is Hubert Kleinekink. I live in the Netherlands, but I'm also known as Mr. Haki. Basically, I think I'm better known as Mr. Haki than with my real name, but I work as a software developer consultant in the Netherlands, like I said, a company called JDriven. And in my spare time, let's call it spare time, I write blog posts about things I learn. And one of the things I started doing in 2008 was learning about Groovy. And I really liked Groovy compared to Java, because I was also a Java developer before. And all the things I liked, I was writing down on blog posts. And during the years, so it's now 7 years ago, it's quite long now, so a lot of blog posts have been written by me about Groovy, Grails, Gradle, Spock, Eskidoctor. I also started with NetBeans, so if you're a NetBeans user, maybe there's some tips there as well. That's a long time ago. You can find it at mrhaki.blogspot.com. You can follow me on Twitter as well, at mrhaki. The code for this thing I'm going to show today, I have sample code prepared, so it's already available on GitHub as well. So you can download it there. And it's also for me, if something goes wrong, that's my fallback. That's a thing to have. And also, all the blog posts about Groovy are bundled into basically an ebook. You can, this one you have to buy from Leanpub. It's the Groovy Goodness Notebook. Let's see if my internet still works. Yeah, there we go. So there you can buy it, and you can have bundles with the Gradle and the Groovy. And there's also a Spock one and Eskidoctor notebook, which contains also a bundle of the blog posts I've written, which are both free, by the way. So you can just download them and take a look at them. And I always try to update them as well. That's the nice thing about Leanpub books. If you buy them once, if I do an update on them, so if I have new blog posts I add it to the book, you get the download for free from then on. So that's a good thing. Those were my slides. It's time for the code, right? So let's get Groovy on this one. So my editor of choice, the Groovy console. That's really a thing I also do like about Groovy when I started to learn about Groovy. I worked at a company and they had us given desktop PCs. You were not allowed to install anything, but you could browse the internet. There's also a Groovy web app console. If you guys don't know it, you can look it up. It's a web application where you can type Groovy code, you can run it, and can test Groovy as well. So this for me was one of the first things I did with Groovy, go to the web page and try out Groovy things. If you're allowed to install stuff, of course, on your laptop, you can install the Groovy console. It's part of the Groovy distribution. It's basically a Swing application. You type stuff at the top, and at the bottom, you can see the output. So if you've never seen it, there you can see it. Is the font size OK? Everybody can read it? OK. So one of the things what I want to start out with is I don't have real sections where I'm going to show, just going to show a bunch of code. So that's one of the first things I want to show is with Java 8, there were some new things introduced into the language. One of them is, of course, the Streams API, but also new language constructs like lambdas, method references, constructor references. And that syntax is not supported by Groovy, but we can go around with it because instead of using lambdas, we can use Groovy closures, which makes it also useful in using the Stream API in your Groovy code as well, if you can use Java 8 as your platform. So let's create a simple list. So a simple list with two string values. And then I can call the stream method, which is the Java 8 method to turn this into a stream. Then there's a filter, and there's a map, and there's a collect I can invoke. And both the filter and the map methods normally would have lambda expressions if this would be Java code. Because we cannot use that in Groovy, luckily we can still use closures. We can just remove the parentheses, of course, as well. So let's say I want to filter on everything that starts with letter M, and then do two uppercase on it. And I should be able to run this. So here you can see the end result. So I'm still using the Java 8 Stream API. Instead of lambdas, I can use closures, and it still works, which is really, really good. So instead of using the closure like this, I can also make it refactor it a bit. So let's say I can assign, of course, this to a new variable. Where's my cursor? And then do it like this. It should still work. Of course it does. A nice thing one shows, if you have these closures, you can also make them more reusable. This one is still only looking at the letter M as the first letter that needs to be part of the word, but we can also make it different. So we can say the letter I'm looking for, and there's a word coming in. So the word starts with a letter. Notice this time I have two arguments for my closure. So the it implicit argument I cannot use anymore. I have to give the explicit value in this case. But also this filter starts with closure needs to have one method. So that's why the nice currying comes in. Like this, and then do it like this. Run it, and it still works. So now my starts with closure is really a reusable part of code which I can use on all other parts of my program as well. As long it's basically a recipe to find words which start with a given letter. And by using curry, I'm basically saying, oh, this letter argument has always the value m for this closure instance. So that's really also a powerful concept you can use. Another thing I want to show is, for example, if I have a class, let's call it a converter class, and it will convert a string value to uppercase. So there's a string to uppercase here. And I will make it static. So this part I want to replace using basically a kind of method reference you have in Java 8. So in Java 8, I should be able to say something like, I think this is the syntax. I don't even know, but it looks kind of Java-ish, right? So it could be. So this would be a method reference. Basically, you turns the method into a lambda expression you can use in the place where it's needed, basically, in the Java 8 code. In Groovy, we have a way to convert this method, basically, to a closure instance using dot ampersand syntax. So that turns this into a new closure, and still works. Let's try it with a different, see it's really still something else. Yeah, so the code is still applied. So that's a way to have kind of method references, but we're still kind of cheating by using still closures underneath, but still, it's another way to have the closures reusable in your code as well. The nice thing is this method reference syntax, like the dot with the ampersand, if you're not in control over the converter class, so maybe it's a Java static class somewhere else in a different library, you can still reuse it the same way like this. So even other Java code can be used like this, which is nice. So let's create a user class with a property there. Add to string. The add to string annotation, for those who don't know it, it's an AST transformation, which means this transformation, if it's applied to a class, will change the compiled source code, basically, and the bytecode as well. And for this case, the to string annotation will add a new to string method implementation to our compiled class file, which also has a default nice way to. So let's just show. So when I create a new user, I can just say, there it is. When I do print line u to string, you can see in this line it already prints out nicely a to string implementation. I can show later on there are different ways to customize this as well, but that's not the point of this exercise, so just leave it. What I want to do in this map method, instead of turning this string into uppercase, I want to create new user objects. The name must be the value of the strings I pass in there. There is not something like user. Just this is again Java syntax. So this means there's a constructor reference you can use as a lambda expression in Java. would be nice if there would be something like this in Groovy, but there's not. So we have to kind of do it differently, but we can make it work. That's a nice thing. So let's say I will call this create user. There is a meta class invoke constructor, which kind of does the same thing. I'm now turning my constructor into a method closure, and I should be able to pass it in here. Create user, clear the output, and rerun. There you go. So, it's could not find method constructor for user Java long string, which of course is true, because I did not create that constructor. That's Java does not like map type constructors. So I can add a new constructor here. Why should I? There is also canonical. There you go. That's also an AST transformation, which already does multiple things. It adds an implementation for the string, an equals and hash code, and also adds constructors for each of the properties I have in my class. I only have now this name property, so this will add a new constructor with an argument of string, which will assign a value to the name property. So let's run, and now it works. So just a little code to make a lot happen. That's also the nice thing in Groovy. It's really dense and really nice to play with, and especially in this kind of things. So still, although Groovy does not support all the Java 8 syntax things that were added in Java 8, we can still use Java 8 methods and APIs, but differently using Groovy closures. So that's the important thing to remember here. Also, if there are any questions during the presentations, please ask them directly, because I don't think we have any time at the end to do any questions. So please feel free to ask anything. Another thing I want to show, of course, in Groovy, working with collections is always a breeze, especially compared to Java. If you've been to the Groovy and Scala presentation by Marco, you can also know that in Scala it can be easy to use collections, but with this is now the Groovy goodness part, so I will show things here. So let's create a list with some values. So let's say we have string gradeconf us, then we have something like Groovy, Gradle, Grails, as string values for my list. There's also something called with default. So I will put it after here. So I have this list with four values already there, and I also can specify a with default value. So let's say default. When I do a print of this list, so I want to see the contents of this list, it just has those four values I've defined. But the nice thing comes when I want to access an element which is not already part of the list. So we have four elements. Let's go with five. And I get the value default. Nice. Although when you look at the contents of my list, this is now what happens. So my list is expanded. So there's an extra element in there, but there is a null value. So I skipped one, which is now replaced with a null value. If you don't want that, there's also with eager default you can use. And as expected, then it fills in those empty slots, which you did not access yet, with the default value you have specified there as well. So it's kind of a lazy list thing going on here. Could also be used, for example, if you have numbers, you can say there's an empty list with eager default. And there's also a closure implementation which takes an argument, which is the index value. So it just could say index. Now I should be able to say print line list, then followed by the list. So let's run it. Oh, numbers. Sorry. It already spoiled it now. There you go. So a different way to create a range. Of course, there are different ways to do it in Groovy as well, but It's quite a powerful way to have lists and to have them expand automatically if you want to have default values if things are accessed which are not there. Normally you would get exceptions, and this way you still can give values back, and maybe that's probably what you want there as well. So staying with collections, one of the new methods that were added in Groovy, I think Groovy 2.3 or 2.4, is the way to swap elements in a list. So basically there's a swap method now, and which takes two arguments, the first and the second index of the element you want to swap. So let's move our great conf.us element to the last element in the list, why not? So you can now see the elements are now swapped. Grails was first last element, now it's the first, and the first element has become the last element. And that's the thing with Groovy, each version, the major changes have been in Groovy 1.8 and so on for the collections API, but still in each version they add some new stuff to it, and just trying to keep up with release notes and see stuff that's added there. And then you can see those little things popping up. Like talking about popping up, there is also on collections API a pop and a push method. So let's do it at least. So what you might expect, the pop element returns the last element of your original list, and it will also change your list as well. So you can see I invoked now the pop method, which will pop off the grills string basically out of my original list. And when I print out the list contents, it's really removed. And of course, I can also push elements on there again. And the elements is there again. Because of operator overloading in grills, also the plus sign can be used to add elements to a list, and there are other ways to do it. This is also something most people will recognize. But again, in grills, there are different ways to get to the same point, basically.
Is there an operator pop off the front?
Sorry?
Do you have to reverse pop reverse, or is there a way to just pull off the front?
There is a way to pull up your front, thanks, because that's what I want to show next. So we have this list of elements. There are different ways to do it because, well, it's not popping off. That's differently. Yeah, there's no real pop to get it from the first element, but to get the first element, different ways to do it. Maybe a nice thing to add, maybe as well. I have to think of a name of it. But yeah, I think it's not that difficult to implement, and maybe we can add it to to the group of good ways, right? what I also want to show is to get elements from a list, basically. I think most people will know this is a way to get to the first element of a list, but there's also a method for it, which is called first. So when I run it, it gets my first element of a list. For those who want to do head or tails, there's an head method, which gets to the first element. Let's do a print line here. And then I can say, oh, print line tail. So the head returns the first element, the tail method returns basically the rest of the list as a new list. And there's also a way to get to the last element using last. And to get the first elements in a list up until the last, there was also an init method introduced into Groovy 2.4, like this. This basically does the reverse of what we did with the head and tail. So the init method returns a new list containing all the first elements up until the last element in the original list. It's a bit added there as well. So another way to work with lists, let's say I want to take the first two elements of a list. There's a take method, which just it just returns the first two elements of my original list. But you can imagine, for example, you have a longer list, you want to have a top five. You just say take five and it takes the first five elements. But if the list is shorter, let's say I do now take 20, but my list only has four elements, could have an exception normally, but this case just give back the four elements of the list because it's smaller than the 20 I ask for. That's still something I need. I don't want exceptions or anything or null pointers. It's just this is what I want, so this is what I get. The thing what mostly works with Groovy, that's the nice thing about it. So instead of taking, we can also drop elements of it. So say the drop 2. So now the first two elements are dropped of my original list, and I get the last two because I have four elements here. And also when I drop more elements than are in my list, it will just return an empty list, and there's no exception or whatever. Notice this goes from left to right, and in Groovy 2.4 there is also a drop right added to the syntax. So now it's going from right to left, dropping the last two elements of my list, and of course if there's drop, there's also take. It also works. It should only return a new list. Yeah. Yeah. Luckily. We will see some methods that will not be so nice to lists or collections in Groovy. That's something. Instead of just using a number, we can also use a condition here. So instead of taking a number of elements, there's also take while, which takes a closure. And that closure can be a condition on which needs to be true until it's false, all elements are returned for the true conditions, basically. So let's say it all starts with GR, so that's a bit of a take while it starts with great, right? It should only have the first element. There you go. Yeah. So that's correct. There's also a drop. Well, so now it only drops the one that is satisfying this condition in the closure, and it returns all the other ones. So instead of just using a number, you can also still use condition with the closure and using drop or take while methods. So like you mentioned, is this list alterated or not? In this case, it's not. But one of the things in Groovy is there's an sort method. Maybe most people have used it already. So I can say, okay, let's sort this. Yep, it's sorted now correctly. So it's sorted, continue with this thing, but then the trick is, when I do a print line of list again, my list contents is altered. It's probably not really what you expect or want. There's really a big side effect using the sort method. And it also applies to, let's add Groovy here. There's also a unique method, which should return all unique elements in a list, which it does, but it also alters the list. So it even removes an element from my list. Probably not really what you expect. So in previous Groovy versions, there was an extra Boolean parameter I could use here, which is false. So when I do sort false, I get back a new list, which is nice, and the original list is not changed. I can even make this list immutable, so I really can show that things are changing. So now sort is not supported anymore because my list cannot be altered. And now it's working again. I think the API developers of Groovy thought, okay, sort false. People will try to forget that. Let's add a new sorted method. Why not? So there is also a two sorted method added to Groovy 2.4. Which it also does not alter the list, but you don't have to specify the false argument anymore. So let's run this. Yep. Sorry?
Does that mutate
the list? No, this one does not.
It just gives you a new list.
Yeah. And also because now using this little simple immutable thing, it really is immutable list, so this code runs, so it shows it with really a new list as well. So. But I think it's better to rely on toSorted than using the old sort method, because then you don't tend to forget the false Boolean argument. And if there's a toSorted, there's also a toUnique, of course, to do the same thing. Yeah. Yep. Let's. So instead of toSort, I can specify a condition toSort on. So let's say sort on size. Then the sorting here is different. This is new list instance again, and the original list is not changed. It's still the original list, so. I think they just added it for making sure that people will not use the sword and forget the false. That's probably why they did it, but it's something you really need to know it's there, because it's really just in the release notes, and if you don't read those, then you cannot know it's really there. So that's the thing. So if we go back to our lists, and in that another thing that's been added to Groovy is a way to get access to the indices of the list. It's correct, I know. That's a nice range printout. I didn't know it would do that. Okay, so there's a different implementation of showing the results, but what this property does basically, it's get indices, returns all the indexes of the elements I have basically on this list. So that's what it does. We can use it for some maybe nice thing. So let's say I have an alphabet, starts with A, ends with Z. And I get all the indices of this alphabet. So let's call it like this. There you go. And I can combine those together. There's a nice transpose method in Groovy. Let's see what it does. Yep, thank you. It's also a nice thing in Groovy, if something is mistyped, it's only captured at runtime, but still, it's never has a nice way to say, okay, maybe you tried something else, and then also the solution is there as well. So I mentioned in the beginning, I need you guys as some of my code completion IDE. So I will just put this one in comments, rerun. So what happens now is I have this alphabet, which is basically a collection from A to Z. I have the indices for this one. This is 0 up till 25 in this case. And using transpose, I'm creating this little tuples, basically. And so I have a list of tuples which says A, 0, and B is 1, and C is 2, or whatever. And you have this combination of different values you can maybe use in calculations, or maybe want to try to find out different values or whatever. You can still use it in different ways. That's quite powerful. So there's also another way to do it. Why, of course there is. There is the with index method, which does basically the same thing in one go. There you go. So I don't have to specify first the indices and use transpose. With index returns all these nice little tuples. And it takes an argument as well as a starting point, basically, of your index. So when I specify with index 1, which most non-programmers would expect, the first element should be 1, right? So in this case, A is 1 instead of 0, and that's how you can work with it. This returns the tuples, so we have a list with values A and 1, but we can also return it as a map, and there's the indexed method for. So this returns a map, basically it's same kind of content, but differently structured. The index is now the key, and the value is basically the letters we have in our alphabet. So. And also, I used already the 1 as an argument. If I don't have an argument, of course, it starts at 0. That's the default behavior. So let's have a bit more fun with collections and creating new collections out of collections, which could be fun. So let's have create a card deck with a little Groovy code. Those are hearts, there's spades, clubs, and I guess it's diamonds, right? There you go. Then I can say, okay, from 0, 2 to 10, plus jack, queen, king. That should be okay. I can combine those, why not? So let's say cards is, do the combinations of those two collections. And I got my card game, basically. That's this is my full deck of cards, and I can use it if I want to. I can also say cards, find all it first. So the first element is hearts. This would turn all the hearts in my card deck, basically. So that's a way to work with it. This can be useful. I can use it quite a lot if I'm writing tests using Spock. And Spock has this nice little data-driven testing thing going on. And if you use data-driven testing, you can also specify iterator or iterable objects for it. So it can run the same test with different values. And by using this kind of methods added by Groovy to Collections API, you can already build up some nice content for your tests, basically. So instead of combinations, there's also other things I can do. So let's just stick with our family of cards. Let's find all sub-sequences of this set of elements. So what Groovy now does, it creates a new collection, and it's just basically combining all different elements in new collection elements. So let's see, find all where the size is 3. So these are all the different, basically, subsequences we have in the original list. And then this contains only 3 elements. So we have for different elements different ways to find it. And instead of subsequences, we also have permutations. Let's show first the complete list. So it's still each element is 4 elements, but all the ordering is different each time. So then I don't have to use this one. So also little utility methods added to the collection API. Probably won't use in your daily programming, or maybe in testing environments can be useful to have extra data for testing. So also want to show is some of the AST transformations added in Groovy. We already saw, for example, toString and canonical annotation. And those AST transformations really alter the bytecode that's compiled basically as in the class file. There are a couple of there out there. I think most of you know the toString equals and hash code. But there's also a really nice one to add some sorting and implementation of the comparable interface to your class. So let's say I have let's create a course which has a name, there's a start date, and let's say there's a maximum number of people that can be allowed in there. So there could be a Groovy course. It's called Groovy start date. Let's say it's next week. And only 300 people are allowed. Do a Grails one, start date, say tomorrow, and there are about 240 people allowed. Let's add this to a list, and I want to do some sorting on it. So let's do println courses to sort it. We just learned about this new method, so we can use it directly. Maybe just do a general import, so I can apply a simple toString just to show that still works. I will also add a package, why not? So that's about it. Let's run it. And it shows probably what we expect. This is the contents of my list. It has been sorted. I don't know on which element, but somehow it has been sorted, but we can make sure that it's sorting in the correct way. So there is the sortable annotation we can apply just like this. And what it does, it implements the comparable interface. So it now is also implementing the compare to method for it. And it uses the ordering of our properties in the source to see how to sort it, basically. So it will first sort on name. If we have multiple elements in our list which has the same name, then it will look for start date and then do the sorting on that one. If that is the same, it can also do it still on the max integer value, which is there. So let's run it. And now you can see Grails is on top of Groovy, although in the original list, it was after the Groovy one. So you can now see it sorts basically on the name part. And when I change the order of my, it's now, the output is the same, but it's now sorting at least on this value. So that's something to keep in mind if you use the sortable annotation. The ordering is important. If you're a Rails developer, you probably know already the ordering can be important for some things. But of course, you can still yes, you can. There's the includes, and there's also an excludes attribute for the sortable annotation. And I can say, for example, I'm not interested in using all the attributes of my, all the properties of my class for sorting. I just want name and max to be one. Oh, let's clean it. Yep, thank you. Of course, it's still the same. Let's say there are a lot of people coming to our Grails course. So. Now it's still sorting on name. I haven't tried it yet because of your question. Let's see if I can turn this around. Just do first max and then name, right? That should work. You can't. No. No, we cannot make it like this. It's always the same way this way. Then you have to really implement to compare to yourself again. Yeah. You have to do some stuff, yeah. So instead of it implements compare to, but it is also adds some new static methods to our course class as well. And those return comparators, which could also be nice. Let's say to sort it, I can now say course comparator by name, which is a method. And now it's sorting by name again. I think you can even see it if I do a print line on course declared methods.name. This should print out all the method names in my compiled class, basically. So here, yeah, at the bottom line, you can see it now has added a comparator by name and a comparator by max method. And when I just remove this includes part, it should also be the start date as well. So now you can also, there's also a comparator by start date. So, so this also shows that the AST transformation really adds code to the compiled class file. That's really a powerful thing there. So maybe you want to apply this toString or, yeah, why not toString and add sortable annotation to multiple classes at the same time, and you don't want to copy it every time. There's also the annotation collector annotation. Nice. Which has an interface. Let's call it. Yep. And here I specify toString and sortable. And now I can use my new name. And everything, oh, everything should still work. Let's do this one and remove the last one. There you go, it still works. Now, these toString and sortable annotations accept basically properties or attributes with different values. The annotation collector tries to apply those if you specify them here as well. So that, for example, when I do includes here, it will try to see if the sortable annotation has includes attribute. If it does, it will apply this name. And if the string has includes, then it will also apply to the toString annotation, which might not be exactly what you want in all cases, but it still works. You can see now that the toString implementation has also been changed. It only shows now my name at property of the course class, and it does not show anymore the start date or the max value, which was there. So let's go back and just look at a bit more of the toString annotation properties. So we already saw that in the toString annotation, we can include fields. Just leaving out other fields can be done using excludes, so it's also possible. But there's also something called include names, which I will always find handy to use in my toString annotation. This one is, of course, gone now. Let's run it. So now it shows the package name, the class name, and it also shows the name of the property followed by the value. And in the previous way, without include names is true, it only shows the value of properties. Maybe even though it wants to show the package name. So now it only shows the class name. It's a bit shorter. In this case, it's a short package name, but sometimes in projects you can have this big com dot whatever, whatever dot part in front of it, and maybe you don't want it in the output of the string implementation. Just you can remove it. Let's also add a new null value to see how that shows in the output. So I have this start date with a null value. It's just showing null. If you want to ignore it, you can. There's ignore nulls. And now, in this case, you can see the start date is null, then it's not even shown in the toString output. And finally, a tricky one, cache is true. So this means the first time you invoke the toString method, that value is cached for basically ever. So I have this grill scores, and I run this. I have this print line to sort it, so that's the first time my toString method is invoked. So let's say I want to set the start date now, 10 days from now, and do a print line on grills. Just keep it simple. Well, to make it even more obvious, let's just change the value. There you go. So the first time I set cache is true, toString is invoked, the value is cached. Even though I changed my max property value, even the toString will also still have the old value of the max property. So this really, I would not use it that often, but maybe if you immutable objects, it can be useful. Just have it cached, I mean, then it does not have to be recomputed anymore. So I think that's the point where you can really use it as well. Let's see, talking about immutable, if you went to Ken Cousins' talk about GPARs, he also mentioned the immutable annotation. The guy, in case you didn't know yet, there is an immutable annotation you can just apply to your class files, and when you run it, it makes your properties immutable, basically. So we get an exception, because I want to change this max property and set it to a different value. Which is not allowed because there's an immutable annotation on top of it. So it's a pretty easy way to turn your classes into immutable classes, and they can only be constructed once, the values can only be set once, and then cannot be changed afterwards. And there's also an attribute there that's been added in the latest versions of Groovy, and that's copyWith is true. What this does, it adds a new copyWith method to this class, which creates basically a new instance using all the same values of properties that has been set on the original course class. So we have, for example, start date. Let's go like this. And I want to create a new grills course. And it only has a different date, for example. I can now say grills copy with start date 20 days from now. Course has a different name. There you go. And now it's already a new immutable instance. So grills 2 is also immutable, but I could have I've changed the value just by using the copyWith method, and after that I cannot change it anymore. But it can be a useful way to have new instances of objects which should be immutable, and only some property values need to be changed. That's way to do it. Another thing I want to show is, let's say I have an event class, and maybe people have seen it before, and I have a start date for this event class and an end date. I have a name, maybe even description. We have a delegate annotation in Groovy, which basically says, okay, every call to a method which is not in my event class is delegated to what I've annotated as a delegate. So there you go. Should of course have the import Groovy transform. Because Groovy already has this implicit imports a lot, I always try to forget, tend to forget this one, but still we need it. Let's do it to string. And let's create an event. Create conf. There's a start date, which was 2 days ago. And an end date, which is today. This should just do as expected. And the thing is now, I can just invoke a method on this one, like say this event before new date minus 10. I can run it, it's false. The thing is, I've used delegate annotation on two properties of my class, basically, which are of the same type. So which before, this should be a date before implementation, but from which date instance? Start date, end date, I don't know. So before we couldn't change it, but now we can. We can have different ways of excluding methods or including methods. So I can now say excludes, let's do the after. Excludes before. Yeah, it's probably was the correct one the first time, but still it should work. At least it shows you how you can really tweak how the delegation works. Before it was still like, okay, probably the first one wins or the second one, we don't know yet. But with includes and excludes attributes, we can really fine tune it and say, okay, certain methods from the object from the class needs to be delegated and others will not be delegated. That's a really powerful thing, and that has been added in the latest release of Groovy as well. Let's see, there's also what I want to show, maybe there's a little thing. Let's say this Groovy. There's the logging annotations. Don't know if people know it. If you apply add log, you get the Java util logging automatically injected in your class file, and which means there's, for example, let's make a method here. It's called message. And now there is a log variable I can use to display info. And let's do event.message. Removed a lot of stuff. So here at the bottom you can see now the output of my log statement. Using this one, it's using Java util logging. There's also one for SO4J. There's a log for J one. What I want to show is this log name, log variable name basically. It's by default in lowercase, but we can of course change it if we want to. So now I can say logger.info. And we still have the output. Just if you don't like log, a small case, you can still change it, right? So, and then you can put this into an annotation collector and whatever and have it applied everywhere. That's a nice thing about it. Have you guys heard about the builder annotation, the HD transformation? No? Well, some guys did, okay. I'm just gonna quickly show you the different options on that one. Quite many of them as well. So let's say we have this event, and we have a name and we have a description. This really powerful way of creating new objects using a Fluent API, basically. That's what it does, this builder annotation. Which can be useful if you're in a project and you have to define, for example, the model classes of your project, and it's a Java project, and that part you want to do in Groovy, because Groovy, of course, has this nice way of defining objects little pogos, and the getters and sets, you don't have to write them, you don't have to generate them, you just type string name and the get and set name are generated for you automatically. You have this two-string annotation, canonical annotation, whatever. All those things are compiled into class files. If you put them in a jar, you can give them to a Java developer and it still works. They don't need Groovy for that. It still is code that still works. And also the build annotation makes a fluent API for creating new objects. So I now have something called event builder name. Let's say create conf us. There's description. And there's a build method. Now, it's there, so let's add to string. I should be able to do a print line. It just should create a new object for me. If it's correct. Ooh. It's in a different package. So let's do import Groovy transform builder. There you go. And it works. So now we have a new instance, but created differently. Yeah.
Is there a way to provide default values?
No. I think not. Yeah, like this, but that's probably not what you meant, right? No, they don't have the default. Would be a nice addition, I guess. And this is only, there are different ways, they have different builder strategy implementations. This is a simple one, and there's something called builder strategy. And they have different files. For example, they have an external strategy, so you can create in this case, the event class is under our control. We have the source, so we can apply this build annotation on top of it, no problem. But maybe you're not in control of that class. Somebody else built it in Java, whatever. It's in compiled class file. You cannot change it. There's also a way to have this, for example, and then builder. The builder strategy. I think it's called external strategy. And then can have an event builder. I have to say for class event. And then this is under our control, so this is the Groovy part, but when we compile it, it's still a class file and we can give it to Java developers, and then they use the event builder to create new instances of event, for example. It's also a way to work with it. If you've not used it before, it's a nice way to check it out, and it's really, I think it's a powerful addition as well, and I think it's a nice way, if you can add defaults to it, it should also be nice, and makes it even more powerful. There is a variant available of a builder strategy. I think it's called initializer strategy. It's a lot of words, but it's also, if you do compile static on it, even checks if required properties are set or not. You get a compile time error. You try to compile code which does not set all the required properties. So to end off with nice little Groovy things, I was like things like, let's say I have a message builder. Let's do it differently. Let's call it converter. And I want to express really what I want to do in my method name. So I have switch. What I really want to do is switch. I see Marco, so I use types here. Let's do it like this. That's reverse. So this should basically switch my string around. That's what I want. So I want to use the word switch as a method name because that's really my intent of my code. So why not? So let's make it static. So let's run it. Oh, it does not work. Luckily, we're in Groovy land, so if I turn this into a string, it's allowed. I mean, why not? It's not allowed because it's basically a reserved keyword normally, but now it's not anymore. So still in my online 7, when you look at it, well, it's just code, right? So switch this into something else and it works, and then okay, it's a string, but that's the thing. Another nice thing that has been added, let's create a calendar instance. Let's say year, let's do it like this. And there's a month, let's do calendar. This month, let's create a second instance. Why not do it like this? Copy with month. So we saw the copy with the immutable annotation, but it's also added to a calendar, for example. So I can just do August. Yeah. The nice thing is there's now an upto method added to the calendar. Upto has been around in Groovy for a long time, so things like upto 5 followed by closure always worked. So it just prints out 1 to 5. It also works for calendar objects now. So C up to C1, print line format. Let's do it like this. There you go. It starts here and then just goes down. We have all these dates now available and it's up to. In the closure, we can just access each date value for each day we have here. Just a little thing that's been added. I've done a lot of user classes, right? So just do one more. Traits, it has been added in 2.4, I guess. That's the latest one, yeah. Which allows you a different way to combine your classes, basically have some kind of multiple inheritance. Let's do something here. There's an ID in this class, then I will have a method called generate. Let's say ID is boo. This should be right. So this trait has a property, it has a method, basically it has kind of state, right? When I want to apply this trait to my user class at compile time, it's possible. I can just say implements identity. And this will add this ID property and this generate ID method to my user class implementation when it's compiled. But sometimes you cannot do it. It's sometimes the user class is already there. You have not the source code. You cannot change it. You can also do it using some Groovy syntax. So let's create a new user, which has a name. Use S as a keyword. Identity. And now I can just do generate ID. And it works. So just by applying S identity, I'm basically at runtime applying this trait to my user object instead of at compile time what we normally would do with an implements keyword. If we have multiple traits, let's add one more. It's called version. That's type long. There is a with traits method which we can use. Sorry? Yep. It works. So I can also change to CUDA. And now you can see it's 10. So just a way to play with traits. Finally, what I want to show is this Groovy console. It's nice. It's way nice way to work. It's basically a Swing application. We can do some stuff with it. And let's prepare something here. In the Groovy home folder, which basically is in your user home, there's a .groovy file, .groovy directory. If you put a file that's called output-transforms.groovy, it's picked up by the Groovy console. And I will show the contents of it. Basically, there's an implicit transforms collection, and you can apply closures to it. In this case, of course, we have a result. And we can make checks for it. For example, if the result, which is basically the last statement of the console, if it is there, what you normally would see, in if you do not print lines, it always displays, okay, the console result is of a certain value. In this case, what I want to do is, if the result is a string, it starts with HTML and ends with HTML, it's turned into a JLabel, so it can have some graphical way of showing it. If the string is greatconf.us, it will show a picture, and otherwise it just says, Groove says, following the result. That should be the goal of this one. I need to restart it, otherwise it does not pick it up. So there you go. So let's create a nice let's do some bold, some italics. And run it. And now you can see it's a JLabel implementation of this value. Still showing that if we can have something else, so I can do hello. It now says Groovy says, followed by hello. That's also what you saw in the implementation. And the last one, that's the I want to end with. There you go, we have the image. So thank you for your time. This was the Groovy goodness part. If any questions? So thank you for your attention and enjoy the rest of the conference.